Sometimes we have data available in one system and we want to work with it in a different system. For example, using data from a legacy API in a modern frontend application. One approach to sharing data between pieces of our architecture is using data brokering patterns. Data brokering is a process of moving data between different systems in a decoupled way. This saves us from having to rewrite the underlying systems in our architecture or make them directly aware of each other. In this tutorial, we'll define what data brokering is, identify the problems that data brokering can help us solve, and we'll talk about different techniques we can use to broker data between systems. Let's take a look at the problem set that data brokering aims to solve. Technology itself moves very quickly, but the systems we use in our application architectures often can't change or must change slowly. This is for good reason. Architecture rewrites are risky and expensive affairs, so it makes good sense to try to avoid them when possible. However, requirements often change faster than the pace of technology itself. We rarely know what the needs of a system will eventually be when we're first creating it. In today's world, our applications are using more data than ever before from a variety of sources. Sometimes that data is locked away in a legacy API, a third-party system, or otherwise siloed off somewhere. If all your systems need to know the ins and outs of how to access this data, things can get complicated quickly. As requirements change, separate systems will need to communicate in ways which they weren't communicating before. As an example, imagine you need to access data from your accounting system to help understand which items in your inventory aren't selling well. Let's assume that your accounting system and inventory systems were built at different times with different goals in mind. The two systems are both core to your business, and making drastic changes in either one is a risk the company isn't willing to take. You still need to work with that data, but want to limit any changes that need to be made to the systems themselves. If we need to make two systems talk to each other, where do we make the change? To access your data where it is and get it wherever it needs to go, you can build something that sits between applications and facilitates the transfer of data for you. This glue piece of software will sit between systems and facilitate the transfer of data in some way. That glue is what we're talking about here, and we're calling it data brokering. Data brokering aims to expose data from one system to another without those two systems having to know anything about each other. Data brokering helps us separate concerns in architecture. The glue software brokering data between systems needs to focus only on that one job, nothing more. The systems we're connecting can continue to focus on what they do without having to make drastic changes to expose its data to others. This approach is generally useful in the applications that we build, but is extra useful when working with systems where we don't control our sources of data or aren't able to modify them. Think about working with third-party services or legacy software in maintenance-only mode. Ultimately, data brokering helps us create decoupled applications and services. They're decoupled in the sense that each piece is not heavily dependent on the others. We can make changes in one part of the system without breaking the other parts. Node.js is particularly useful in data brokering applications. There's several key reasons why this is the case. Node.js benefits immensely from the ever-expanding NPM ecosystem. Just one benefit of that is providing us with packages for interacting with a wide range of data sources. Using packages available in NPM, you can get up and running with connecting to almost any type of data source. Just find an NPM package which helps you connect to the type of data source you're using, and you're ready to start writing code, regardless of whether that data source is an HTTP API, WebSocket connection, MySQL database, or anything else. The wide availability of packages and tools written by others makes quick iteration possible with Node.js in a way that it isn't with other languages. It's relatively easy to get a Node.js application up and running, and by using tools available in NPM, we can reduce the overall amount of code that needs to be written and reduce the time-to-market cycle inherent in building software. The event-driven design of Node.js also works quite well with data brokering techniques. It's a good choice for servers or other processes which spend a lot of time sitting and waiting for work to do. It can also handle a large number of concurrent connections on just a single thread. This event-driven model also works quite well in serverless environments where we are only paying for the time our code was actually doing work. Instead of maintaining additional servers in your stack, your Node.js data brokering applications could run on a serverless platform and only run when there is data to process. Node.js also has a gradual learning curve. If a developer is already familiar with working in JavaScript on the front end, they can apply a lot of that knowledge to building applications in Node.js. This keeps the cognitive load low for working in Node.js and allows more developers to work on the back end because JavaScript is such a common language among web developers. All that sounds good, but I'm sure you're wondering, what does data brokering actually look like in practice? The data brokering techniques we're going to focus on are building a thin proxy API, extract, transform, and load pipelines, also known as ETL, and working with message queues. In the context of data brokering, a proxy API is a lightweight API server that translates requests and responses between another underlying API and an API consumer. A proxy API presents a friendly interface for consumers to another API service. In this example, a consumer is any client or application which wants to request data, and the underlying API service is the source of the data that the proxy API communicates with to fulfill the request. Taking a step back, a proxy API connects a known service to any number of known or unknown consumers, without the consumers having to directly communicate with the underlying service. You can think of a proxy API as an intermediary between a service and its consumers. It's an API that translates requests from a consumer into requests that the underlying service understands. It can also restructure or otherwise transform data received from the underlying service into a different format that the consumers are expecting. The benefit here is that you can expose a stable and easy to work with interface from the proxy API to the consumers, while custom tailoring the data returned from the proxy API however you see fit. This diagram shows a client making a request to a proxy API. The proxy API translates the request from the client into the GET request that you see and sends the request to the underlying API service. The API service sends a response back to the proxy API, which the proxy API then transforms into the response to send back to the client. The diagram is based on the example we're going to talk about next, so feel free to come back and take a look at this again after we go through the example. For an example, let's consider working with the NASA Exoplanet API. It's a publicly accessible API that lets you get information about exoplanets which have been discovered. The Exoplanet API expects requests with SQL queries passed through the query strings in the URL and returns data in JSON, CSV, or ASCII format. The response data is ugly, not quite human readable, and often contains data that we don't care about. In general, it can be fairly confusing to work with. We could use a proxy API to sit between the consumers and the NASA API to expose a friendlier interface that lets the consumers make requests however you want them to. This helps us by translating the requests sent by the consumers into requests the NASA API can understand. And conversely, the proxy API will translate responses from the NASA API into responses expected by the consumers. So, to recap all that, some of the key benefits of a proxy API are they help you work with another API by creating a layer of abstraction over those services and acting as an intermediary. This is especially useful when dealing with legacy APIs, APIs in exotic formats, or APIs that you don't control. A proxy API allows you to expose a friendly and stable interface to consumers for an underlying service. And if the format of that underlying service changes at any time, you can make the appropriate changes to how the proxy API talks to the service without having to break the API contract you're exposing to consumers. Another method for data brokering is using an ETL pipeline, which stands for extract, transform, and load. ETL is a process with three general steps. It's often called a pipeline because the data moves through these steps from beginning to end. These stages can take many forms, but the general idea is this. Data is first extracted from wherever it is housed. This could be a database, an API, flat files, or any other source. Next, the data is transformed in some way. This can be restructuring the data, renaming keys in the data, removing some fields entirely, computing new values from aggregated data, or any other data manipulation which converts the data you have into the format you need it in. Once the data is transformed into its final form, it is loaded to the destination. Again, that destination could be a database, flat files, or wherever else it needs to go. This diagram shows the flow of data from its source through the different stages of an ETL pipeline and into its destination. ETL pipelines are typically run as batch jobs, meaning the ETL process is run when the data needs to be moved. That could be once an hour, once a month, or any other schedule that fits your needs. Some of the major conceptual differences between a proxy API and an ETL pipeline is that both ends of an ETL pipeline are known, and ETL is run as a batch. With ETL, you know where the data is coming from, where it will end up, and usually you know when the work will be done. With a proxy API, you don't necessarily know which clients are going to consume the data, and you let those clients make their own requests as they're needed. An example use case for an ETL pipeline could be aggregating data to use for analytics. Let's say you're tracking user activity on a website, clicks, page loads, and things like that. You have a database that holds the raw activity data. At the end of every week, you want to aggregate the records together by time of day, and then load them into your data warehouse where you can perform analytics on the aggregated data. At the end of the week, your ETL process kicks in. First, the raw data is extracted from the database. Then, the data is cleaned, validated, and aggregated in the transform stage. Finally, the transformed data is sent to your data warehouse where you can then run analytics on the dataset. This is a simplified example, but pretty accurately reflects many real-world use cases for an ETL pipeline. To recap, ETL is a process which works on data in three separate stages: extract, transform, and load. ETL is most appropriate when you know where your data is, exactly where it needs to go, and want to transform it along the way. ETL works well with batch jobs where you want to move a bulk amount of data at once. And if you have a very large amount of data, an ETL pipeline is a practical choice for moving it from one location to another. Message queues are another powerful way to broker data between applications. A message queue persists messages sent to it by a producer until a consumer is ready to handle the message. A message can be any piece of data, like a log event, a row from a database, or any piece of data which is being sent from one part of an application to another. Messages are persisted in the queue in the order that they were received. Producers add messages to the queue. and consumers take messages off the queue. Consumers can process messages either one at a time or in batches of multiple messages at once. Messages stay on the queue until a consumer informs the queue that processing was successful. This diagram represents the flow of data with a message queue. You can see that producers are producing messages which are getting added to the queue, the queue is persisting the messages in the order that they arrived, and consumers are taking messages off the queue to process them. A producer can send messages to the queue and not worry about waiting to hear back if its message was processed or not. The message will sit in the queue in the order it was received until a consumer is ready to handle the message. This relationship makes message queues an asynchronous communication protocol. That's in contrast to synchronous communication protocols like HTTP, where first a request is made and then you wait around for the response to come back before the request is finished. Message queues are also highly resilient and scalable by design. If messages arrive faster than the consumers can process them, the message just sits in the queue waiting until a consumer can process it. You can scale up consumption just by adding new consumers to the queue or increasing the batch size each consumer processes. And if there's a failure with a consumer, messages aren't lost. They're persisted on the queue until they are successfully handled. This makes message queues fairly fault tolerant. Let's think through an example of using a message queue to deliver webhooks. In this scenario, when a commit to a GitHub repository is detected, a producer sends a message to the queue saying a commit was made. The message will arrive at the queue and be persisted in the order that it was received. Eventually, a consumer will request the message from the queue, and based on the information in the message, the consumer knows that it needs to make a post request to a remote server. Let's assume that the remote server failed to respond. Instead of just giving up and discarding the message, the consumer leaves the message on the queue to be retried again later. Realistically, it would probably re-queue the message at the end of the queue or otherwise back off trying the request again, but regardless, the message stays in the queue. Eventually, a consumer encounters the message again and retries the request. Let's assume that this time it was successful. The consumer lets the queue know that the message has been successfully processed and the message is removed from the queue. Additionally, if at any point there's a sudden spike in the messages being sent to the queue and the consumers can't keep up, more consumers can be added to the queue to help clear the backlog of webhooks to be sent, or the consumers can consume larger batches of messages at a time. To recap, some of the benefits of a message queue are persistence of data. The messages are persisted in the queue, so if something goes wrong during processing, the data the message represents isn't lost to the abyss. Message queues decouple producing messages and consuming them. A producer doesn't wait until the message it sent is processed. It's just pushed onto the queue, and at some point in the future, the message is handled by a consumer. The producer isn't waiting around to hear back from the consumer. This can be called asynchronous communication. The asynchronous nature of message queues is very beneficial for handling spikes in load. Message queues buffer the messages they receive before they are processed. If you receive a huge spike in messages suddenly, they're just absorbed by the queue. Your consumers will get to them when they get to them and aren't explicitly affected by the increased load. Message queues are also very scalable. You can add more consumers or increase batch size of consumption to handle increased load and work through the backlog. If your consumers are taking messages off the queue at the rate that they're being added, then the processing is essentially happening in real time. The queuing of the messages should only really add a few milliseconds of latency. In this tutorial, we define data brokering as connecting different parts of our applications together while keeping them from directly relying on one another. We identified some of the problems that data brokering can help solve, and we explained different techniques for brokering data between your applications, which include creating a proxy API to sit between an underlying API and the consumer making the request, ETL pipelines for moving data from one known source, manipulating it, and then loading it into another known location, and processing data asynchronously using a message queue.